So what we're going to do this afternoon is we're going to tie some flies. And the flies that I've chosen are from the caddis family, which are one of the more popular ones. And I'm going to do you a larva pattern, a pupa pattern, and also an adult pattern. So better get busy and get at her. What I'll do is I'll pass these around. There's one here that I won't have time to tie, and that's probably the emerger pattern. But they come in various colors, and they're a major food item for trout. Probably about 10 or 15% of their intake would be with that. So the hook I've chosen, it's a fairly long shank. It's a curved shank hook, and the first one I'm going to do is the larva pattern. And I'm going to start my tying thread. I've got to put my glasses on so I can see what I'm doing.
The one thing I don't like about the one thing
yeah.
is
old age gets all of us.
That's like a better
stuff. And the larva has a little bit of a tail on it, so I'm going to choose some marabou. I'm just going to take a marabou feather, which is a bird, and I'm going to dress it down. If you're a fly tier and you tie woolly worms or something like that, this is very similar to what a woolly worm would be, except it's just my own rendition and just something that I feel is really more appropriate. I'm going to do this one in a tan color instead of the olive, and I'm going to use marabou. I'm going to use a ginger hackle, and I'm going to use a pheasant type of hackle as well. Start your marabou. I'm going to use a very short tail. It just sort of has an appendage out. And what the caddis larva is it's a free swimming larva. When you see caddis in a lake environment, they will build a case and they'll have sticks around it. They'll get bottom debris and all kinds of things, and they will build this case around themselves. And when they outgrow their case, they will go free swimming, and that's when they're on the food diet for fish. And so as their case goes, they're gonna molt, and they're gonna build this case about six different times during their life cycle, which is a period of 2 or 3 years. And when they're ready to pupate, they will actually start turning into a caddis right inside the shell. And then what's gonna happen is that the pupa will come out of the shell and he'll swim towards the surface. But this larva is more like the worms of a lake bottom.
Eventually, and they're actually a fly that flies into this air. Right?
They become, yeah, and I'm going to tie that for you with what I've shown you there. So this is actually the worm stage, and it's the free swimming stage when the larva is running around trying to build itself a new case. I'm going to tie in a little bit of a tail. Marabou. Stuff out of the way. They see that okay? Yeah, it's turning out pretty good. So I'll tie a tail on first. Often I will weight this pattern because it spends most of its time or all of its time on the bottom of the lake. But just for purposes of tying the fly today, I'm not going to put the weight on it. I'm going to choose a ginger hackle. Actually has segmented little hairs on the larva, so this is going to represent the hairs on the larva. I'd like to trim the fuzz off that, and I'm going to trim this sort of stubby, so I'll do that before I put it onto the fly pattern, and I'll just choose to trim this hackle off both sides before I tie the fly. It's either do it now or do it later. I think I'd do a better job with it if I do it now, and it can be sort of rough tag as well. So I'm going to tie this in and bring it back. And I'm going to wind this hackle through the body afterwards. Crystal antron. The caddis themselves can be tan, they can be olive. Dark olive, they can be light olive, they can be a very dark brown. A lot of it depends on the bottom vegetation of the lake you're fishing. if you're in a tannin colored lake, which would be a brownish colored lake, you're often going to find the darker brown type of, you'll find the darker brown caddis, darker brown pupa, darker brown larva. Everything in there is going to be dark brown. If you're in a weedy lake, it'll be olive. I'm going to do the brown one. So I just wrap this crystal antron chenille on and I take it up to the front. And then I'm going to wind this on. Tie that off pleasantly. And with a rotating vise, it makes it a little bit easier because you can just wind it. Tie it off about there. Careful not to cut the thread. I am going to put a head on this. This is why I'm leaving quite a bit of room at the front. Now I'm going to wind this hackle through. And this is going to simulate those little hairs that are gathering on the worm, as we call it. If anyone ties or buys a woolly worm, basically you're buying this type of thing. And trout like them, I guess they're juicy. Because I like to offer a little bit of movement to a lot of my fly patterns, I'm gonna tie in a little bit of a pheasant hackle. So I'm gonna take some rump feather or shoulder feather off a ringneck pheasant. I'm going to tie a few of these hackles in. Do that by trimming out the centerpiece. I'm just going to lay this hackle over top. Even though you won't see antenna or something like that on a woolly worm, what this does is it offers a little bit of movement to the pattern, because this hackle will flow around a little bit, and it's just another enticer for fish to take a strike at it. Put it like that, now I can pull it back and get it to the length that I want it to be, just by pulling on the fibers a little bit in the front. And that's about what I want. And to finish this fly pattern off, I'm going to put a head on it and I'm going to use Peacock Girl. I know it's you. Take a few strands of Peacock Girl. I'm going to tie these in, and I like to put them in a dubbing loop, just adds more strength to it. Find it, tie it on, to give it a little bit of a head, which is quite prominent in the larva. Okay, so that's my finished larva pattern almost. Just got to tie it off. And we'll move on to the pupa stage.
I don't even know.
So in the life cycle of a caddis, this is the woolly stage, the woolly worm stage, or the larva stage. And it is available as a food item to trout. I think they like to eat them as much as they would like to eat a garden worm. And
there she is. Glue? Is that glue you just put on?
Yeah, I use a little bit of head cement. Yeah, get some glue. I was going to bring a attention. So that's it there. Then I'll pass that around. and I'll move on to the pupa stage. And what the pupa stage is it's a very short-lived stage. The caddis will actually pupate inside. The worm will pupate inside the case, and it has wings and it has all kinds of things. And when this pupa hits the water, somebody's got the flies there. When this pupa starts to emerge, what it's going to do is it's going to swim, and the appendages. See the pupa there, and if you compare it to the larva, sorry.
Here we go.
If you compare it to the larva, it's a it's about the same size. It's got a head on it. It's got ribbing on it. It's got some coloration on it, and it's also got the swimmerettes. And the swimmerettes are these little golden pheasant tibbets here it swims like this. And sometimes it'll swim for half a day, about a foot under the surface, before it hatches into the caddis, waiting for proper conditions, weather, nightfall, all kinds of different things. But the biggest time they're available is actually in that free swimming stage. And you would use a floating line and you would fish it just under the surface.
It wouldn't take too long to make that, eh?
Okay, so let's tie one of those guys up. Again, we're going to use the brown tying thread. And you'll find that these the pupa are multicolored. Thanks. That's good. The pupa are multicolored, so what they'll have is they'll have like a cinnamon colored body with a green rib and a green thorax, or they'll have a green body with a yellow rib with a cinnamon thorax, or they'll have a gray body with a yellow thread or a green rib and a different colored thorax. They're multicolored. When you see them hanging around in the water after they've hatched, they're actually, you can see the ribs, the colors, and all kinds of different things on them. Kind of a neat thing to watch. So I'm going to use a green rib on this one. And I'll use a green thorax, and we'll use a cinnamon kind of a dubbing to tie and put it on. I'm going to attach my ribbing. To about there. Didn't cut this off the other day, and I went around and around on my rotary. And what I'll do with this one, if I have the time, and I'm not going to take the time today, is I'll actually build it up with a little bit of thread at the back end, because the caddis pupa is thicker at the back end. Like a dragonfly nymph is more thick towards the middle, but a caddis pupa is thick at the back. So what I would do is take some embroidery thread, and I would just build up a subbody at the back. I would take some of my head cement, put it on there, take some pliers, and I would squeeze it, and I would make a little bit of a cut back end for it. So when I put my dubbing on it, it's gonna take on that shape. Shape is very important in all kinds of flies. But I won't do that today for lack of time. I'm gonna build my dub body now. Little bit of dubbing cement. Get started here. This is dubbing. What it is it's available in a variety of different colors, but. Back in the day, 40 or 50 years ago, when I first started tying flies, it was mostly seal's fur, and they would color seal's fur. Today, you've got all kinds of synthetic fibers. They use a blend of different fibers. They can put a lot of sparkle in things and all kinds of things. And you can buy these in all kinds of different colors. It's called dubbing. And it makes excellent bodies, because what it does is it holds the, it traps air bubbles, which are very prominent in a nymph, a larva, pupa, an insect, the air bubbles that it traps underneath the surface. And that's what that glossy antron color, See that sparkle in there? That sparkle really gives it a look of air water entrapment, air bubbles. I'm going to dump this onto my hook. I've used some dubbing wax, and dubbing wax just makes it sticky. And the heat from your fingers when you're putting the dubbing on actually heats up the wax and makes the fiber stick to the thread.
Spring's coming, eh?
Dub it like that. Got a dubbing needle, which has got a double prong end on it. Take it out. I'm going to move my tying thread up to about the 2/3 point. I'm going to counter wrap this for the dubbing. So I'm just wrapping this body on. And I'm going to tie it off about here. And I've got a little bit thicker at the back end, which is what I wanted to do. I'm going to take my ribbing. And I'm going to bring that ribbing up. Now, a half hitch here. I could cross thread this, or I can just put it on the same way that I've wrapped on my other. I don't like my ribbing be real prominent, but I want it to be in there. Sec, I need my scud back stuff. He wouldn't know what to look for. Hang on, one sec. Forgot my stuff. I was going to make a little wing case out of. So here it is, all ready to go. This is what they call scudback, and it's plastic material. It wasn't available over the years, but now you can get it. And all it is a small plastic strip that we use for wing cases. You can use it for scud back, for putting over top of your shrimp. And it comes in a variety of colors as well. I don't need this thick, so I can trim it. And I think for lack of time, I'm just going to fold it over and double it. For this presentation. I'll just double it over. What I want to tie on here is a little bit of a wing case, because it does have one. This wing case is going to go, and I'm going to put a thorax in front of here now in a different color. Which I'll choose an olive. So, same type of dubbing procedure. I'm going to put that on. I'm going to leave about two eye lengths back because I want to put my swimmerettes on. What I've chosen here is golden pheasant tippet. I'm going to use these to imitate the swimmerettes that that this pupa will swim with when it's in the water. So they're just going to be sort of like legs. I'm going to put them on each side. And they're going to project down and back. They're going to sweep back. And simulate the swimming paddles that the pupa uses to get to the surface. And I'll just take a few fibers off each one. And I'll put it on the hoop, about the same length. And lastly, what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to also put a little bit of pheasant in there, just like I had on the last one. This is going to represent a couple of little antennae that flow out the back. Strip the pheasant. Take and cut the middle out of it. Pull some fibers back. I'm just going to lay this over the top. Again, what we're simulating here is motion and movement, and these fibers will flow in the water and they'll pulsate and they'll give the pattern a feeling of life. I'm going to take this wing case and I'll bring it over the top. You could use pheasant, you could use different things for the wing case, but I think the scudback does a nice job of imitating the wing case, which is usually glossy in appearance. And again, what I'm going to do now is I'll take my peacock girl. I'm going to build up a little bit of a collar just to make it look good. And also simulate a rather large head, which is what they also have. Dubbing hook. And I'll tie it on like so. And there we go. This is the pupa stage that this larva stage has morphed into. And it is now a free swimming insect that is going to become trout food. These patterns are kind of fun to tie because they're not just like a couple of items. You're putting several different things in there and you're also giving it some life and you're giving it a little bit of a personality. You can call an insect having a personality. And there we have it. That's the pupal stage. I'll pass it around. Anybody that's interested? We having fun yet? All right, it's good. I'm going to do the adult stage now, of the caddis. And this is something that that everybody dreams about, is catching fish on the surface. We love to do it, and this is probably the best fly in this country to do it with. I want to get her good and tight because I got to do a lot of reefing on this one. Okay. And I'll do you one in the green color because it's probably the prettiest, but actually the gray ones are the best up here. But I'll do one in this caddis green. And what we're going to use for this one is pretty much all deer hair. Just deer hair and dubbing is what it is. That's got to be tight or it's not going to work for me, that's for sure. First thing I'm going to do is prepare a little bit of deer hair. I like to use good select deer hair, not the stuff that my buddies have shot and given to me, but stuff that's been tanned. It's made a little nicer to work with. Deer hair has a lot of under hair in it, so you want to clean that out. This fly takes a little bit of time to tie, but it's definitely worth it. For the tailing, I don't use as much as I use for the body, but I'll put it in my deer hair stacker. And what that does is it evens the tips of the deer hair out, so you don't have tips that are going off in all kinds of different directions when you're trying to tie your fly. I'll pull it out, and what's happened is that the deer hairs have become even. The short ones are all the same size. I'm going to tie in a little bit of a tail here, just for a tail fiber, so it looks like it's got some tail. And I'll wrap this from the front all the way up the hook. Do a last tie underneath it. And I'm really going to come back and really get this tight because I don't want it to spin afterwards. Use a fairly heavy thread, either that or use monocord for this. But I like the UTC thread in the 140 denier. And it's nice and heavy. I tie my small flies, my small dry flies, with the 70 denier, but the 140 is really good for deer hair. I can barely break it by pulling as hard as I can. Okay. So the key to this is you got about two turns of dubbing, and we're going to do it about three or four times. And in between there, we're going to put stacks of deer hair. As said, the dubbing I'm going to use is this caddis green. I'm only going to need about two turns of it, but I'm going to do this three or four times and put stacks of deer hair on top. So just a couple of turns, tie it off on the third one. Then I'm going to take another stack of deer hair, about a pencil width, it's about the right size. Again, clear the under fur out from it. And I'll put it in my stacker. Stack them nice and neat. I'm going to start packing this on, basically coming back to the back end of the tail. And each successive wrap of dubbing and deer hair is going to be packed onto each successive one. All the way up the hook. You have to do this about four times. This fly, some people will use tom thumbs, which are used for similar fishing circumstances. But this one is way, way, way more durable than a tom thumb. I've taken up to 20 fish on one fly. And if it's tied correctly, it'll stand up for a long time, and the deer hair, you just throw it up in the air, cast it a few times, and it shakes itself dry. When I'm finished with these patterns, when I'm finished tying them, what I usually do is I use something like a boot spray, like a silicone boot spray. And I'll spray my dry flies with a silicone. And when I'm on the river fishing with them or on the lake fishing with them, I also use a desiccant for shaking the excess moisture off them. I also use a float to keep the flies floating. But the silicone works really well. So continuing up the hook, I'm just going to keep stacking some deer hair on here. This is probably one of the more difficult patterns that you can tie as a fly tire, because working with deer hair, some people never ever get used to it. But what I've found is it's more quantity than anything. If you use too much, you're going to be in trouble because it'll flare and it'll spin on you. So don't use as much as you think you need. And stack that on just right behind it again.
It's fine.
Because I don't want it to spin, I'm going to be tightening her down pretty good at the end. More dubbing. Probably takes me about 20 minutes to tie one of these, even if I'm tying them fast. But they're one of my favorite patterns to fish with, that's for sure. Especially on the lakes around here. And I'll tie similar ones for the rivers around here, but they'll be smaller than this. Lakes have the big hatches of insects, and the rivers have the smaller hatches in size. Just going to keep bringing this deer hair forward. Until I get to the front, and I'm going to put a couple of hackles on, and then we'll be done with her. You can get these, get deer hair in a multitude of colors. A lot of it's been dyed. You can get it bleached, and they all have their purpose for different fly fishing situations. As you see, I'm just sort of stacking this up. Just making a good, really tight knit for the back for the last one.
Hi, Ross.
One more stack of deer hair is going to do it. You go. This is my last stack. And then I'll hackle the fly and then we'll be done with it. Need good strong thread, because you've got to get this stuff tight, otherwise it'll spin on you. more hair you got on there, the more it's going to spin. So on here, I'll use a grizzly hackle. Grizzly sort of gives it a variegated color. I'm going to choose one about the right size for me. Take a whole feather. By the looks of it, that's a good one. You want to take all of the barbs off your hackle that have a whole bunch of fuzz on them. So you want nice, clean, sharp hackle. Put a grizzly on, and in front of it I'm going to put a brown hackle. Choose one about the same. There are hackle gauges which will tell you what size you're putting on here, but after 45 years of time flies, I kind of have a pretty good feel for what I want to do, so I don't use the hackle gauge very much. Hackles on. There's the rooster. Brown one first. Just take about three or four turns of that. Off. And I'll take the grizzly. Do the same thing. Tie it right through the brown. Stage, the pupa stage, and the adult stage. Just going to put some head cement on this puppy. Then I'm going to take and I'll trim, fly out. I'm going to trim the bottom even with the hook gape. So what happens is when this lands on the surface of the water, it's going to ride upright like that. That's kind of the trick to it all, rather than having them lay on their side when they hit the water. You want to take and put a little V in there so it stands on the outer ones. Back the ride of your fly. And that, my friends, is it. That's the three of them. And I thank you very much. Any questions at all?